ugly. I always talk about the financing, but the ugly is that today I sent $5,000 to WHCR because we owe them $50,000.
Do you think that all colored folks are just second class fools, Mr. Backlash? I'm gonna leave you with a backlash blue. Backlash. I'm gonna leave you with a backlash blue.
Once again, this is a collaboration between Progressive Community Media and Radio Vision, and I'm your host, Bernard White. And the discussion today, we continue to talk about the election, the upcoming election at WBAI. It's called the Local Station Board Election. And we have been joined by Pauline Park. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Bernard. It's great to be here.
Oh, good. Bob Lederer is here with us. And Five Mwalim Ock.
Thank you.
Five Mwalim Ock. We're going to, I got a feeling we're going to really know that name after a while, because you bring a lot to the board and we'll probably be hearing your name a lot.
Hopefully.
Pauline, you just got elected to the board?
That's right. Last year, I was invited to join the Justice and Unity Coalition and join their slate, and was elected to the board in December. And I've been serving on the LSB since January. Unfortunately, we haven't had a quorum at any of our meetings from January through August because of the boycott by the Indy Caucus ACE people, members of the board. But we have continued to meet, and we've continued to deliberate and to do the work of the local station board of WBAI.
What on earth made you decide to become an LSB member?
Well, other than Bob and John, I think it's that WBAI is a unique resource for the people of New York City and the metropolitan area. It's a voice for the voiceless. So many people, LGBT people, people of color, progressives, people who are engaged in various forms of struggle, supporting social justice, listen to WBAI and rely on the station, as they have for many years, to keep informed and to provide a platform for discussion of so many important issues that are not covered by the mainstream media. I'll just mention the fact that I've been on a number of different programs, most recently on Out of FM with John Riley and Naomi Brussel, discussing my LGBT activism. One of the issues that is rarely covered, and rarely covered very well by the mainstream media, is the issue of the illegal Israeli occupation of Palestine. I've been involved with Palestine solidarity work, mainly through the New York City Queers Against Israeli Apartheid, which I co-founded 5 years back. And that's an issue that is rarely covered in the mainstream media and very rarely covered from the perspective of the oppressed, those who are actually living under the occupation. And so WBAI, as I say, is a unique resource for New Yorkers to be informed about the important issues of the day. And so I decided to join Justice and Unity, and was very honored to have been elected by the listener members of the station.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of the things that I'm getting, there's a theme that has run through all of the people that I've spoken to with Justice and Unity about why they want to become a part of the LSB. And in having spoken to some of the people on the other side, on the Indy Caucus, there's a direct divide between what they think the station should be and what you think it should be. They always point out that it's a business. And the people on Justice and Unity always speak of it as an instrument that can be used by the people to inform them themselves. And I think that the emphasis is very different, and the emphasis determines what approach they have to dealing with the station. And I think that's reflected in how they've been behaving so far. Do you find that to be the case, Bob?
Oh yeah, I think that's very true. And there's an extra irony to the fact that they're always talking about, you know, we have to look at this as a business, which of course, on one level is obvious, right? That you have to pay the bills of the institution. But we're, the Justice and Unity campaign is the group that has consistently tried to focus this board's attention on that very issue. We're the ones who put together a really comprehensive plan to make the station sustainable. It's been having chronic financial problems for, you know, upwards of almost a decade, and yet whenever we've tried to put something forward constructive, we've tried to reach out to the other group to work with us, they've just snubbed us and said, we're not interested. And so, yes, of course, there has to be good business planning. We've been part of that. We are planning, we are currently working with management, despite this boycott of meetings that prevents us from formally passing motions, except in emergencies. We've been just rolling up our sleeves and starting to work with management on how do we raise money off the air? How do we give the listeners some relief from this chronic, every few weeks back on the air to beg for money and offer premiums? So we're doing the hard work. They're not willing to. They just want to throw bricks from the corner and file lawsuits against the Pacifica, that's our parent network, when they don't get their way in elections, and which then drains further money from our till. So, you know, it's a very tough situation that we hope the voters will see through the deceptions and even lies that they're putting out, such as the one they're currently peddling, which is that Justice and Unity wants to sell the station to commercial interests, which we've repeatedly said we're adamantly opposed to and will never in any way allow to happen.
Well, you know, I know about that, because they even accused me of saying that I wanted to sell the station after we did so much to build it up. Now, you know,
right. It's
ridiculous. Five, you had mentioned something about fundraising.
Yeah, but I have some fundraising ideas. I comment too, and I think that I've seen the same argument play out in the scenarios and the sort of the circles that I work in. And it was around, I worked hard with Cory Booker, and over 2 years, worked on the Fair Chance Act, and it was a huge bill and unpacked to basically decarcerate America in a federal system. And I heard that same argument from the private prison systems, right? When GEO and CCO says, well, you know, this is a business, right? We have to run it like a business, and we're actually into real estate. And I'm like, well, no, you're into slavery. You're into incarcerating people, and that business is people. So even though this is a radio station, it's also, like I said, a symbol of democracy and where everyone has a vote, where everyone has a voice. And it's an equal platform. It's a public platform, right? And that is actually protecting the interests of the community and protecting the interests of a democratic society where each person's count, each person's issue has equal, not propaganda. Like, it doesn't get accepted by mainstream media. WBI has always been that community source, you know?
Mm-hmm. You know, we talked about folks that were incarcerated, but there are also thousands of men and women that are on leashes.
Yeah. So, you know, me and Peter Wagner just had this talk. He has a prison policy institute. He's the guy that said, you know, we have 80 million people who are just disenfranchised from employment. That was because of census. The numbers is actually up there to almost 100. Right? There's only 320 million people in America, period. So literally one-third are previously incarcerated or directly impacted. Right? But there is a separation of that. Number two, it is 2016. It's time for us to start looking at fundraising in a different way. There's also the digital era. You don't have to sell to the digital era to get your voice out there in some sense. And there's little improvements that could make the station better. But that's what I'm about, improving and recreating, but also maintaining the history and the viability of the station, not to sell it. I don't know where that propaganda came from. But to protect the interests of people's voice and to be a voice for the voiceless. And like I said, this station has been since I was a young child, and I feel like it's a duty to me. Not an opportunity, but a duty and a responsibility.
Mm-hmm. So why is this station important to the LGBT community?
The LGBT community, until, I've been involved with LGBT activism for 22 years, and I would say until the last 5 to 7 years, the mainstream media really was not interested in covering the LGBT community. Now that has changed, but mainstream media coverage is still, I would say, rather superficial and in some ways misguided. The thing about WBAI is it is really community-based radio. The mm-hmm. people who put on the programs are members of the community. Many of them are activists. I've known John Riley and Naomi Russell for many years. They're stalwart members of the LGBT community, but they also work intersectionally in many other communities on HIV/AIDS issues, on Israel-Palestine, and bring a perspective that is both community-based and progressive and intersectional. And you don't get those voices. You rarely hear voices like that, progressive voices informed by an intersectional perspective on multiple oppressions in the mainstream media. When you do get coverage of LGBT issues, it's rather superficial, in some cases misguided, it's overwhelmingly white LGBT people, very mainstream and rather corporate, and they tend to focus on and or take their lead from the largest national organizations in the country, which, to be perfectly frank, are all either corporations or turning into corporations. And so WBAI is really different in that regard and quite unique in terms of the of the local media here in New York as a platform for LGBT people to discuss issues of significance to the queer community. And so it's a unique resource and one that I personally really value. And if you look at Justice and Unity as a group of people, we represent the full diversity of the communities that make up this great city, both in terms of diversity, but also in terms of our backgrounds, in terms of our activism, our commitment to social justice. We're all in the trenches, working on a whole range of issues, including mass incarceration of people of color, including LGBT rights, including Palestine solidarity. And so that's why I really value WBAI and why we all have to work to ensure its continued survival. And I think the Justice and Unity campaign is absolutely committed not only to the survival of the station, but to making sure that it thrives, that it becomes once again a leader in local media in terms of covering all the issues that we've been talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of the things that I was thinking about was that you've been on the board for 8 months now. How does it feel? I mean, can you just describe to the viewers just what is it like when you've been elected to a board to perform a certain function, and half of the board decides that they're just not going to show up?
Well, it's a little bit strange, to be perfectly frank. I have been on a dozen different boards. I've run a number of boards. I'm still president of board of directors of Queens Pride House, which is the LGBT community center in the borough of Queens. I'm chair of NIAGRA, the New York Association for Gender Rights Advocacy, which is a local transgender rights organization. So I'm used to not only serving on boards, but in some cases running boards. And so it's a bit unusual to be serving on this local station board at WBAI for 8 months. We've had 8 board meetings at which it's only the Justice and Unity folks who've shown up. And the members of the Indy Caucus, the ACE people, have boycotted it. So I actually haven't met, I've only met 2 of them. because they've been consistently boycotting the board.
And that wasn't at a board meeting.
Right, exactly. That was
during the election campaign.
Right, during the election campaign, we were recording cards for the campaign. And so I happened to meet two of them at a recording session. And so it's a really strange situation. It's been wonderful getting to know my Justice Immunity colleagues, but it's been very frustrating and really rather disappointing to see people who claim to be committed to the station who are boycotting the board, frankly, because they don't want to see the Justice Immunity members of the board have any say in the organization. And I'll just say, as someone who has come to the board from the outside, it's pretty clear to me that the Indie Caucus ACE people have really been running the station into the ground. There's been really major mismanagement, and the Justice and Unity members have been fighting to maintain the viability of the station, advocating for really good management, while the other side, frankly, has been running the whole thing into the ground. And the station is in dire financial straits precisely because they have been running this board for so many years. As a result of the December election, the board basically was split 50-50. And so in a fit of pique, they decided to walk out and they boycotted all of our board meetings, which has deprived us of a quorum. But we've, despite all of this, been trying to act to keep things moving forward. And so Bob and other members of Justice Immunity have put together this fundraising campaign, which we're doing on behalf of the station, whereas the Indie Caucus ACE people have been doing nothing but suing the Pacifica Network and trying to undermine the work of the LSB, which they claim to be committed to. So I think we see who has the real commitment to the station and who is basically just focused on trying to maintain their own power on the board at the cost of the viability of the station itself.
Mm-hmm. Bob, do you see a realistic way out of this? I mean, as she mentioned, it's been running to the ground. How deep into the ground is it?
It's deep. I believe our deficit this year is in the range of $500,000, and this is after several years of increasing deficits. And up till now, that's been able to be made up by some of the other stations in the five-station Pacifica network that are doing a little bit better financially, but some of them are going through their own hard times. So it's very bleak, and you know, as I said, we put together this plan that we think offers some viable off-air fundraising strategies, but more than just raising money, it's also about changing the paradigm. Because if we're just stuck with this primarily, you know, old-fashioned radio only and not use all of the wonderful channels that the internet provides, particularly podcasting, where people can regularly subscribe to get a downloadable version of a show, and many, many other innovative techniques that could maximize social media, unless we go in that direction, we are going to wither on the vine. So it's going to be a very touch-and-go situation for the next period of time. And, you know, that's why we need all hands on deck, and we need to all focus on how to save the station. That's the only hope.
Five, if you wanted to make an appeal to people to attend the board meetings and also to vote in the election, what would you tell them?
I would definitely tell them to understand that this is a protection of people's rights, right? I have been a defender all my life of human rights, and this is not only a platform, but this is the people's voice. So we're defending that, but we're also raising up the standards, and we're saying that this can't be continuously to go that way, and without a quorum, without unity, it's not going to move. One of the things we did in the nation's largest hunger strike was the first thing people didn't realize we did was a unity. There was actually a peace treaty that came about before the hunger strike, right? So before actions, you have to have unity. You can't communicate without a quorum. And people boycotting it is just a lack and showing their lack of responsibility to address the issue. When I was young, I used to have Tampa arguments with my sister, too. But if it came to doing things that was necessary to keep the house running, we did our chores and we did our duties. Mm-hmm. So people can't put it aside is the problem, I think. Mm-hmm. And fundraising is also something that could be done differently.
It also seems to be a disrespect for the people who voted for
exactly,
them.
Exactly, yeah. Voted for them, and also listeners. Who's thinking about the listeners? What about the man who is trapped in a cage and relies on a shell to get steady information about what he has to do to get home from parole and deal with the system? And what about the elderly who are home? Like today, there was a huge change in housing laws, right? These things are regular broadcasts and information that people need to get for those services. So we're taking that away, and I think that it's negligence, you know? Mm-hmm.
Because you know that there are some programs that if they don't raise any money, it doesn't matter. That you need a housing program. You need a program that speaks to about mm-hmm. the prison industrial complex. You know, you don't, if it's a business though, then you get rid of them because they're not making money. But if it's people oriented, you know that they have to be there, and what you do is surround them with other things to help to boost them up.
Yes.
Right, and think about the issue of policing, police mm-hmm. harassment and brutality. Huge issue in communities of color, with LGBT people. In the mainstream media, what discussion there is of policing is usually from an extremely biased and rather NYPD-centric perspective. So WBAI is really, really unique resource in that regard. And so the work that we're doing as part of Justice and Unity to try to keep the station going is directly related to the ability of this station to continue to host progressive voices on air, who can bring in activists, people from various affected communities to talk about issues such as housing, incarceration, policing, etc., etc., income inequality, the environment, the environmental justice movement, environmental racism, all these issues. Where else are you going to hear that on the radio dial? Where else do you have a radio station in the city? It's non-commercial, non-corporate, that isn't regularly running commercials from Monsanto or Walmart or large corporations or Bank of America or Goldman Sachs.
Or the Army.
Well, that too. Yes, we could talk about that too. I have a very strong interest in foreign policy, the background in international relations, and so there's a whole range of issues for which WBAI is really one of the very few media outlets in the city where you hear progressive and radical critiques of U.S. foreign policy, of the NYPD, etc., etc., of the corporatocracy, the oligarchy that runs this company, the city. And so the work that we do as members of Justice and Unity, as part of the local station board, is what allows the station to keep on going. But we're facing a really critical juncture now, because the dire straits in which the station finds itself, as I say, frankly, because of the mismanagement of the Indy Caucus ACE people, who have had a majority on the board up until this year, for the last several years, for many years now. So this election, I think, will be rather crucial. It's kind of funny because the cliche in presidential elections is, this is the most important presidential election
ever.
In history.
Right.
Ever. But, you know, it's interesting, I think this election for the local station board may be possibly the most important election in the history of WBAI, because if Justice and Unity were able to win a clear majority, then the Indy Caucus ACE people would lose their ability to obstruct the work of the local station board. And that would be an enormous change.
Mm-hmm.
That could make the difference between WBAI moving forward or, frankly, folding.
Yeah. Well, we hope that doesn't happen. Although, I know that the economic situation is really, really bad. And I'm just hoping that this next election can bring about some kind of change that would accelerate the healing at BAI. You said you had some you said you had some ideas about fundraising. What are some of those ideas?
Well, there's different ways to raise funds without asking the listeners 20 times a day. Like Bob had mentioned, there's digital podcasts. There's also YouTube. There's also iTunes podcast stations, and people can subscribe to shows so that your listeners are already paying for it, right? There is galas. There's different type of concerts. I run a Hip Hop for Human Rights concert, which creates collective statewide coalitions against solitary. That is something easy to put together because the voices and the issues of that are all progressive issues, and it's all under the blanket of what WBI offers the community as a platform. But I think sometimes we underestimate the amount of information people get from WBI. Not only is it a source of voices for the voiceless, but it's also a voice of what's going on in the city, what's happening, what you can get involved with, community programming as well. Those type of things can be contributors on an outside level, even to a gala, a concert, but also to the nonprofit organizations who are doing the work. And I believe that there's different systems of fundraising that we don't have to always rely on the same old way, you know? Mm-hmm. There's crowdsourcing, there's the internet, there's a whole world of social media, and every dollar counts.
Right.
I know for a fact that so many people incarcerated wish that they had the ability to do something to help save the state.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. I was just thinking that, you know, that along with lines of what you said, that, you know, the BAI brings in the Chris Hedges and the Cornel West, but they also bring in the Leroys and Sarah, and, you know, that's what's important. That gives that balance, is that we go in the community and amplify those voices of those people that are actually doing things. So I want to thank you all for coming out today, and hopefully we'll have some positive information to report back after the election.
And if I can give the website?
Bob, give the website.
For more information, go to www.justiceunity.org. That's justiceunity.org. Or you can call our voicemail at 212-591-2111. And there's lots of information about the fabulous slate we have, as well as the positions we've taken, the accomplishments that we've had.
Okay. So thank you very much. Thank you for coming out. And I want to thank Progressive Community Media and Radio Vision for hosting this program. And please, vote. Come out and find out what's happening to your radio station. This is the only radio station that you can actually call your radio station. So thank you very much.